and I ran out of that grave the same way that he called Lazarus out of the grave. He calls us to freedom. Would you please stand with us this morning as we sing?
Oh, Jesus bled and died for me.
always open for this what we do in church. We worship, we celebrate together, and we also pray together. I know even after Easter, sometimes we don't always feel that celebration afterwards. We still have the realities of life, the realities of family struggles, of friend struggles, of people we've been praying for who aren't yet saved. And I'd like to invite you this morning, if you came in this morning with any burdens, to feel free to come to these altars, to lay them down at the feet of Jesus, for he's the one who guides our steps, who knows what is to come and what was. He knows it all, and he is there for us.
Thank you.
victory. And Lord, as we sing, let the lost be found and the dead be raised. If here and now let love invade, Lord, let our church live loud. Because the gates of hell have not prevailed. Lord, the trials that are in our lives will not overcome us. Lord, we believe in you and what you have done, and even more so than the resurrection, even more so, we believe you are coming back again, so that all that is wrong in this world will be right once again. Lord, that all may come to you and believe, and may know a love that can only be known through you, a love that has endless bounds of grace. Lord, this morning we come to you with our hearts full of grace. But Lord, some of us also come with burdens of this life, with realities of this life. And even looking through our prayer sheet this morning, seeing numerous numerous things going on with our families and with health. Lord, I think of Paul Baker's dad who discovered a mass this week, and he's getting it checked out this week, and we know he's nervous about it. Lord, we Lord, we think of the Wilson family who we miss seeing them here. But Lord, they're not forgotten in our hearts. And even though they cannot physically be here with us, Lord, we are just so thankful that you would be with them this morning as they are worshiping in your home. Lord, we pray for each of these needs, each one that is written down, and each one maybe that someone didn't even share this morning. But that we would turn our eyes to you, to not be fearful of the things ahead, but to trust in you, just as we believe in everything that you have done up to this point. We believe what you are going to do. Lord, we thank you just for this past weekend of the Habitat Color Run, and how exciting that was for our church to be involved in our community, and over 100 people signing up, donating to Impact Team, donating to Habitat and participating in that. Lord, we thank you for that partnership that is building between our community, between His Hands and Habitat and our church. Lord, we thank you for the ministry of our First Kids Learning Center, how at Monday Thursday, we had so many families come through the rooms. It was so exciting seeing the children excited to share with their parents what Jesus has done, walking through the garden across the tomb. And then to eat a meal together, share together, to talk with some of the families. Lord, you've given us so many opportunities to build relationships with other people. For that's part of how we go and make disciples. Lord, that's by loving others, by talking to them, by sharing in their lives. And Lord, as we look ahead towards next Sunday, the I Love My City Sunday, we pray that this would also be an opportunity to share your love, to go out and serve community in a very visible way, that's not inside our church walls, but at the Lila Arboretum. Lord, helping out and caring for this ministry field that you have placed us in of Battle Creek, Michigan. Lord, would you continue to stir in our hearts this morning as we continue to worship you. We pray all these things.
Is actually a way this week. We had the opportunity to perform a wedding. So he asked me if I would be willing to stand in and to preach for him. It's great to see you all here today. And bear with me as I'm still getting over the rest of the cold. Alright, so church camp. How many of you guys have ever been to a church camp or know what church camp is? Alright. Church camp is basically a bunch of kids that get together to have fun and learn about Jesus. My church camp had this zip line, and you had to be at least like 8 years old to go on it. It had all these waivers. To get into the zip line nest, though, I wish I had a picture of the tree, because this was like the most shady zip line ever. I wish I was joking. However, to get into this tree, there was this fiberglass ladder that was bungee corded to the tree as tightly as it could be. Sounds really safe, doesn't it? Okay, we had to climb this bungee cord tree into this wooden platform. And once you get up on that platform, they They hook your harness into about a 3-foot tether. Maybe it was 5-foot, I don't know. They hook you into this tether, and then you have to sit down, scoot to the edge of the platform, and scoot off. When you get up there, you realize this platform is blowing in the wind. It is attached to the tree behind me, and 500 feet in the opposite direction, it is attached to another tree. And unlike most zip lines, it's not a tight zip line. If you have seen a lot of them, it's a really tight line. No, this has a little bit of a droop to it. So when you slide off, you almost feel like you're free falling for 10 seconds before it catches, and then it jerks, and then it shoots you down to the other end. You feel like you're going to hit the tree at the other end, and then it brings you back about halfway. When you get halfway back, you have to take the rope on your shoulder, drop it onto the ground so that the person underneath you can catch it and hold onto you while you're dangling from this zip line. Which then proceeds, they have to go over, and there's this huge ladder that is attached to another tree. And when you pull it down, you can see the whole platform shifting as they're pulling it down, and it plants into the ground, and you see the platform bounce, and you see it shake as the person is holding you to keep you from taking off again and trying to keep this platform safe on the ground. Once that's done, they kind of guide you over. You have to climb up 2 steps of the ladder. You sit down on the bench. You unscrew your own harness from the tether. And then, I mean, for little kids, they would obviously come up and do it. But if you could do it yourself, they weren't coming up. I don't blame them. You untether yourself. And then you have to climb down this ladder that feels like it's going to fall apart with every single step that you take. Some of you say, that sounds great, let's do it. Brenda, when I was telling you this story, found it really funny because to me, no. God did not intend for any of that to happen. He intended for our feet to be on the ground, right? But maybe that's just my fear talking. I did the zip line when I was 8 years old, and then I went on to become a counselor at that same camp. And you'd think that I'd done it as a kid, so I'd move past that fear into my adulthood. Nope. They changed it. It's safer. The bungee cord is no longer there, holding the fence or the ladder into the tree. Instead, you have these little metal steps. It's what the people use to climb telephone poles with. You clip it in. And then you climb up, then you get to the rock climbing holds, and then you climb the rock climbing holds. Outside of that, everything else is the same. And so I sat there, and I had people, my fellow counselors were also my fellow campers, people I went to with when I was a kid, or when I was a camp to when I was a kid. And they were like, come on, Tabitha, you've already done it, you can do it again. And I'm like, nope. If God wanted my feet off the ground, he would have made them off the ground. The next year, I came back to be a camp counselor again. Now keep in mind, this is about 10 years later. I came back again. And they're like, come on, Tabitha, you can do it. I believe in you. I have faith in you. I trust that you can do it. And it's like, all right, this year's the year I overcome my fear. I'm going to do this. So I put the harness on, climbed up the tree, got to the edge of the platform, and my fear paralyzed me again. I could not push myself off of that tree. After about 5 to 10 minutes of sitting there, I was on the point of tears. Because I so badly wanted to move past my fear, but I couldn't. And so I had to embarrass myself in front of all of my coworkers and turn around and climb back down the tree. The next year came. This is the 3rd summer in a row. Here I am at the foot of this tree. And I'm like, nope, I couldn't do it last year. Not doing it this year. My fear paralyzed me again. And then I had a friend who had worked with me for 3 years by that point. She looked at me and she said, Tabitha, do you want your kids to enjoy this summer? I was like, yeah, of course I want them to enjoy it. Are you going to let your fear stop you from encouraging them to do it too? And it hit me. How can I encourage these small children to climb that ladder and go off that zip line if I myself allow my fear to paralyze me on the ground? So, I did it. I strapped on my harness. I climbed the tree. I sat on the platform. I took a deep breath. I looked at the boss man and said, "You've waited 3 years to get me down the zip line. If you want me to do it, you're going to do something about it." I said, "All right, on the count of three, one, two, picked me up and dropped me off the edge." Now I went flying. They somehow managed to catch me. I somehow managed to get on that rickety old dismount that was still the exact same from when I was camper, mind you, and climb down safely. It still doesn't sound very fun to me, but you know what? My fear no longer held me captive. I was no longer able to just say to my kids, "Yeah, do it, it'll be fun." But I can tell them, "I've done it, I did it this year, and you know what? If I can do it, you can do it too." I'm pretty sure that all of you have a similar idea of a fear in your head. Isn't it crazy how easily we can allow fear to control our actions? Our passage today comes from John 20, verses 19 through 31. I know you already turned the screen blank. Would it be possible to get that up there? John chapter 20. If you guys would please stand for today's reading. And that's going to be verses 19 through 31. I'll let the video fall as well. When the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And after that he showed them the hands and his side, and the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, then they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, then they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where the nails were, and put my hand in his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands? Reach out your hand. Put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." And then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have now believed. Blessed are those who have seen and yet they don't have not seen, and yet they do believe." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord. You may see that. Easter, and Pastor Ryan gave us this beautiful setup of Mary Magdalene seeing Jesus in the garden, and he encounters her and he says, "Hey, Mary." And she immediately, at the sound of her voice being called by her Lord, recognizes him. She runs to him and she tells him, or he tells her, to go and tell that he has been risen. So what does she do? She runs off. She goes and she tells her fellow friends, her fellow disciples, I have seen the Lord. He is not in the tomb. And of the 12 disciples, two heard and followed. They took off to the tomb. They got to the tomb. I imagine them racing, because who wouldn't want to be the first one to see the tomb empty, right? So they ran to the tomb to find it empty. They go back to the home where their friends were locked behind closed doors. And they said to them, hey, it's true. He's not in the tomb. How awesome is that? But they remained behind the locked doors. They remained behind the locked doors because even though Mary had told them that he is not in the tomb, they let their fears keep them behind locked doors. So they're sitting there, thinking about the fact that my friend is dead. My leader is gone. Is this really it? Is there something more that I should be expecting? They were also paralyzed by the fear behind the locked doors. Because, hey, I followed a man who said one thing and the Jewish leader said another thing, and he was directly opposing them, and I was supporting him in that, so now what's going to happen to me if I go out of those doors? A week later, I'm going to put a lot of time. So they found themselves asking questions like, would they be next? Now that they have followed Jesus, would they end up in prison? What would their life look like moving forward from here? Would society say, hey, you, I'm gonna be like you? Or would society say, nah, I'm done with you? Who would they tell, and who would be willing to listen to them? The fear was real. I think we understand that fear. The fear was real. Maybe even paralyzing. Because now that they had followed Christ, they put themselves at risk. They were hiding because somebody was after them. So, fast forward, I know I'm skipping a little bit of the story that's going to come. So now, here they are, and they tell Thomas, Thomas, we saw Jesus! And Thomas said, I'm not going to believe it till I see it myself. I'm not going to believe it till I feel it for myself. I'm not going to allow that knowledge to sink into my heart because I want to experience it too. So 1 week later, which is when this story, when we do this story a week after Easter, 1 week later, Thomas has joined the other 10 disciples behind locked doors. Thomas has joined them in the fear of being outside of their safety net. He was there with them in their fear. We give Thomas too much of a hard time about this because Thomas was the one that vocalized it. The other 10 disciples didn't say to Jesus, let me see. They simply stayed where they were. Jesus showed them, still, look, here's my nail marks. Here's the spear mark. Jesus showed this to them. And they believed. But they maybe didn't leave the locked room and go tell the story like they were supposed to. But here we have Thomas, and Thomas is like, I'm not going to believe it until I experience it. And we give Thomas a hard time for that. But are we much different than Thomas? Hold on. Yeah. So to this point, though, the disciples only knew to believe through them seeing Christ. Because what have they done? What have they done for the last 3 years? They followed this man. They watched him lead blind people to sight, or give blind people sight. They watched him cast demons out of pigs. They watched him turn water into wine. They watched him turn two fish and five loaves into enough food to feed 5,000 plus. They knew because they have seen. They knew because they had heard. They knew because they had experienced Christ. So their faith was founded on their experiences. So can we fault them too much for sitting behind a locked door saying, what if it was all a lie? Their faith was founded on that. And now that we're here without their leader, on the edge of their seats, waiting and trying to figure out what was next and potentially fearing for their lives. How many times do we find ourselves sitting on the edge of that platform? Our fears paralyzing us from going out and doing what Christ has asked us to do. Fearing and waiting for what was going to happen to us next. Now, I'm going to go back into the text, and I'm going to piece this back together and finish the stories because I know I'm missing holes, and you're like, what? So, here's what happened next. When Jesus, in that first encounter with his disciples in the locked room, when Jesus went in there, he said, peace be with you. And he shows them that he is indeed the resurrected Lord. He shows them, look, I am alive. It is me. My peace I give to you. My Holy Spirit I'm giving you. And just as the Father has sent me, so I am sending you. He is saying, I've told you for the 3 years now that I am real. I have told you for 3 years now that what I am doing here is temporary and that I'm going to ask you to go and to do what I've told you this. And now it's real. I am alive. I am with you. So get up and go. Get out from behind your locked doors. Jesus appeared to them in their safe places. Jesus appeared to them in the middle of their fear and said, go. And then what do they do? They go and they tell Thomas. And Thomas doubts. And Thomas says, I gotta see myself. And Thomas shows up with them in their place of fear. And so while they went out like Christ said, where did they return? They returned to their safe place. They returned back to the ground. They returned back to what they knew would be keeping them from death, from societal rejection, you name it. It was probably keeping them there. Christ appeared to them again and he said, peace be with you. Again, he is giving them his peace. He is in the middle of their safe place and saying, here I am. So much so, Thomas, here I am. Come, feel. Experience me. I am real. It doesn't say anywhere Thomas had to feel it. But it does say that Thomas, in his experience of sight, said, my Lord and my God. He responded with, you are my God. You are my leader. You are the man I've been following after for 3 years. And then he sent them out in a little bit of a different way. He sent them out by telling them, you have believed because you have seen me. You have believed because you've experienced me. You believe because you know that these nail wounds, they're real. Blessed are those who believe without seeing.
But she did not, she was like 70, 80 when she passed away.
When I asked her how it was that she could continue believing in God when the cancer had overtaken her life, she said, because there's no one else that could bring me greater comfort. And I cannot let the fear of my cancer stop me from sharing what God has done for me. I don't tell you these stories to make you feel bad, but rather to make you stop and ask yourself. Ask yourself the hard questions. You see, we have the opportunity to receive the Holy Spirit. Just as people have spread, told us story after story after story, you have the same opportunity that they had. That Christ wants to breathe his life into you. Christ wants to give you hope beyond what anybody else can give you. And when you receive that, then the questions of, is my place going to be the next place attacked? The question of, who will I go to? The question of, God, when will I have the time? Or, God, will my friends still accept me? Will my family let me continue being part of the family? Will I be able to step forward and do this? We are able to say that those fears no longer hold us captive. Because the Holy Spirit looks at us and the Holy Spirit says, I love you. I am with you. You may not see Christ there, but listen to the stories that have been told. Listen to the stories of what our God has done. Have the faith of those that have come behind or come before you. Move past your fears. Move past the locked doors that say, this is what's expected of you, that you're next. Move past those fears. And when you do, you'll be able to spread the gospel. Now, I want to take a moment. Some of you may have noticed that I'm wearing my Habitat shirt. That's not just to advertise for Habitat and the color run. That was a great time. We as a church are called to be the church. We as the church went out into our community yesterday, and we said, Habitat for Humanity and Battle Creek. We love you enough that we're going to bring together the community, and we're going to support the community, and we're going to raise money for Habitat for Humanity. That's great. We as a church should be doing that, right? Next week, we have the opportunity to go back to Layla Arboretum, and we get to clean up our mess, but we also get to make Layla Arboretum look nice. That's great. That is exactly what we as the church are supposed to do. We are supposed to be building up our kingdom. But I cannot let Habitat for Humanity's color run and I Love My City be the only time where I step out and I do something. Because this is still a safe place. Going out into Battle Creek with my church, I'm still locked behind a door. Because it's easy when somebody else is doing it with me. It's hard when I'm doing it myself. But Jesus isn't just calling disciples to go out as a group and say, God loves you. Jesus is telling them individually, just as God has sent me, so I am sending you. So I ask you today, what is your fear? Maybe your fear is, I don't know people. Maybe your fear is, I don't have time. Maybe your fear is, I don't know how. As we get ready to close out in the song, I want you to listen to what the Holy Spirit might be asking you to do. I want you to listen and to hear and ask God, what are my locked doors? What is my platform that is paralyzing me? What is keeping me on the ground? What is keeping me here and stopping me from going out and doing what you have asked me to do?
I know God is calling you to move past your fears.
So let those chains fall away. Let yourself jump off the platform. Get your feet off the ground. Get out the doors. Not just as a church next week, but in your everyday life. Step out in faith, knowing that God is going to put in front of you the person that you are sent to, the people you are sent to, whether it's at the grocery store, whether it is at work, whether it is driving down the road. Maybe God's asking you to pray for somebody. Step out in that faith, knowing that God's moved you past your fear. And go make disciples, because you are sent to do that. You are sent to tell people what Christ has done for you and what Christ has done for those before you. So go.